Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Deirdre De Burka. I'm Irish, but I work in Brussels. And I'm here today to represent the Beyond 2015, or at least the steering group of the EU Beyond 2015 Task Force. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about us, what we do, and about the global Beyond 2015 movement. But just to say, I'm also the Director of Advocacy for World Vision's office in Brussels. I know World Vision is very active in Romania in international development. We are a child-focused relief and international relief and development organization. So the reason I'm on the Beyond 2015 Task Force in Brussels is because World Vision believed it was an extremely important opportunity to try and influence this new global sustainable development agenda and to make sure that the interests of children and young people were properly reflected, not just in the substance of the framework, in the goals and targets and indicators, but also in the processes that are agreed around both designing the framework, but also implementing it and monitoring it. So that is why I am a member of the Beyond 2015 EU Task Force. So what is Beyond 2015? I don't know how many of you are aware of the campaign, but it is a global civil society campaign. It was set up in 2010, and the reason it was set up was to push for a strong and legitimate, what we call a successor framework to the Millennium Development Goals. So it was created in 2010, and it's based on this founding principle that it is a partnership. And we've heard this morning the word partnership comes up a lot when you're talking about the new SDG framework. But this was about a genuine partnership between civil society organizations in the north and in the global south, or in the south as we call it. So a genuine partnership between those. And just to give you an example, the Beyond 2015 global campaign is made up of more than 1,000 civil society organizations from 132 countries all over the world. But what's very often a complaint about these international movements is they're sort of heavy with northern representation and not so much from the global south. I think in this case, it's quite different. We actually have more representation from the south than we do from the north. So 56% of the civil society organizations that belong to this global campaign are from the south, and 44% of them are from the north. So I think it was a good start. Our structures, what do they look like? How does global society organize itself globally? And this has been a really interesting learning experience for civil society, because we often complain about the institutions that we're dealing with, and we say they work in silos, they're very compartmentalized, they don't speak to each other. But the more we look at our own sectors, we realize that if you're in the development sector, you may be very familiar with other actors in that sector, but how much do you know about people who work in other sectors that have a very strong impact on our sector? And the truth is, very often we don't. And what's becoming obvious from the new universal framework that's been agreed for post-2015 is we need to start developing stronger connections with others, because of the fact that many of the issues that we're dealing with, we talked about complexity, are interrelated, and we have to be speaking to people outside of our own sectors. And so for civil society globally, we wanted to influence this new framework, this new global sustainable development framework, so we have to connect up around the world from the south, the global south and the north, but also all the different levels. We have to be effective at a global level, we have to be effective at a regional level, as in the EU, in Africa, in Asia, and so on. And we also have to be effective at a national level, and we have to be effective at a subnational level. And by subnational, we mean within country at a local level. Civil society also has to be effective. So it's a big challenge. So we were only set up in 2010, but these are the structures that we've put in place. So basically, we have a secretariat team. So obviously, I think any international movement that's trying to organize itself has to have some kind of administration or secretariat. It's important. So our secretariat team have staff in South Africa, Belgium, the UK, and the USA. So that's where the main figures from the secretariat are based. We also have regional coordinators, and they're based in Africa, Asia, Latin America, the Pacific, and Europe. We also have national hubs and national lead agencies. We have a Beyond 2015 Executive Committee. It operates in a very open and transparent way, and you can find the minutes of all of the meetings of what we call the ExCom, or the Executive Committee, on the Beyond 2015 website. We also have specific working groups, because obviously the framework, the new framework, covers so many different areas. So we set up different working groups to focus on different thematic issues. And very often there were lead organizations leading on those, and we responded to a lot of the consultations, the UN consultations on different thematic issues. So this is how we're structured, just very quickly. And within Europe, I thought it was important to say something, because I don't know to what extent any of you here are involved in the Beyond 2015 EU Task Force. But essentially, the task force is led, as I said, by a steering group, and it's formed by representatives of the following organizations. So there's a Belgian NGO, a very well-known Belgian NGO, 11111. Bond is the platform, the UK platform for development NGOs. CAN Europe, that's Climate Action Network Europe, Caritas Luxembourg, CIDSE, you're probably all familiar with CIDSE, they work a lot on international development issues, particularly debt is one of the main issues that they're focusing on at the moment. Concord Sweden, the European Environmental Bureau, LAPAS, which is the platform in Luxembourg, the Latvian platform of development cooperation NGOs, the Plan EU office, Save the Children, VSO International, they're a voluntary or an organization that organizes and supports volunteers, World Vision, and the World Wildlife Fund. So when you look at that, you probably get a sense already, it's not just the usual suspects. You can see the sustainability dimension in there, where we have Climate Action Network Europe, we have the European Environmental Bureau, we have the World Wildlife Fund. So it's again reflecting the much broader focus of this new SDG framework. So what did we start by doing? It was felt very important in the beginning that the Beyond 2015 movement would set out its vision for the new framework. And so a paper was published, and the European Task Force launched its position on the post-2015 framework called Putting People and Planet First. So it was really about trying to encourage a shift from this exclusive focus on economic issues, often with environmental and social issues as a very much a secondary concern, if at all, sometimes these issues being overlooked completely, to a much more integrated model of development that looks at the economic, the social, and the environmental. So what we call sustainable development. And to answer anyone who's interested in finding out, well, who can join the EU task force? The EU task force is open to all Europeans, so both EU and non-EU civil society organizations who are working on what we call the post-2015 framework, or the SDG framework. So participating organizations, I suppose one of the difficulty in getting a wide range of organizations together is that we have many different views about what the content of the post-2015 framework should focus on, and had over the last few years, but we were very much united in working together to achieve the following two main objectives. One was we wanted to see a global, overarching, cross-thematic framework to succeed the Millennium Development Goals, reflecting the Beyond 2015 policy positions. We've talked about the Millennium Development Goals here today, and I think we all know it's important to recognize they were successful, and I know Simon Maxwell showed us some of the impacts that the MDGs had, and it's important to recognize them. But we also learned a lot about what wasn't tackled in the context of the Millennium Development Goals. And we know, first of all, they concentrated on a relatively limited number of areas that were the focus of traditional development, meaning poverty eradication, hunger eradication. So we saw 8 Millennium Development Goals. They were about halving the levels of extreme poverty, about addressing child and maternal mortality, about providing universal education, but they were relatively limited. And people are now saying there's 17 goals in the new framework, that's too many. But the truth is, if we want a transformative agenda, if we want a new paradigm that's going to really shift and fundamentally address the issues that give rise to inequality, to poverty, to the kind of migration we were talking about this morning, we need to address so many different areas. So we can't just hand pick a few and say, well, we'll deal with health and education, maybe and poverty in this one, and we leave the others for later. If we want paradigm change, we have to be comprehensive in the way we address all of these issues. So that was our first objective. Our second objective was to ensure in the process of developing the new framework that it was participatory, meaning that there was a chance for everybody to participate, inclusive, so nobody was left out, and a particular focus we felt on people actually experiencing poverty and exclusion we wanted, and also responsive to the voices of those directly affected by poverty and injustice. And that has been a big focus of the way that we work to try and involve everybody. I thought I'd say a little bit about the SDGs, but I know that we have covered them now in our previous presentation. So very quickly, this is, I suppose, the middle point there that I'd like to make is that this is a groundbreaking and potentially transformative framework. I think it's important to say potentially, because opinions are very divided now about, is this too utopian? Is it, you know, crazy? Is it kind of far too ambitious? Or is it something really important, something that can transform and change our world for the better? And I think in one way, it could be either. And that's why I use the word potentially. It will all depend on all of us. Our political leaders, but not just our political leaders, civil society, the private sector, ordinary citizens, academia, all of us, people in the cultural sector, we will all have to buy into this if we want to make this transformation happen. So the other point I've just made very quickly there is that the SDG agenda evolved from what was a strictly traditional aid and development agenda, that was the Millennium Development Goals, to one now that's much more based on international cooperation, and we will have to cooperate with each other in a way that we have never before internationally. And that's why I think the previous speaker mentioned global governance, so I think global governance is going to be something we will have to learn to work together to bring about change globally. So what were our main issues when we were looking at the new framework? We said, first of all, it has to be universal. Did we succeed in that? Yes. The EU very strongly pushed this being an agenda where all of the goals were to apply to all countries. So the entire agenda belongs to everybody. There is a danger still that some countries will cherry pick, and we know there are countries within the EU that say, the EU doesn't really need to concentrate on all 17. We can concentrate on sustainable consumption and production, climate change, and energy. And let's leave the other ones. I mean, inequality, poverty, gender equality. We don't really need to worry about those. But universality means that all goals have to be implemented by all countries, you know, around the world. That doesn't mean that all of them are equally important to all countries. There may be more of an emphasis in some countries on certain goals than in others, but all goals must be implemented as part of the universality. Comprehensive, we pushed very strongly for that, and again, we're very satisfied. This is a comprehensive new framework that covers the three dimensions of sustainable development: economic, social, and environmental. And governance issues are also included. Transformative, well, I spoke about that already, potentially transformative. Human rights-based approach, that's something the Millennium Goals didn't refer to. There was no human rights-based approach underpinning the Millennium Development Goals. It's different in this case. Human rights are integrated throughout the new framework. They will also, I mean, we can't be complacent about it. Just because they're mentioned doesn't mean that governments are going to deliver on them, but we were successful in this. We also talked about the importance of recognizing the multidimensional nature of poverty. Poverty is not just income poverty, so if we talk about somebody on an income of $1.25 a day, that's not a satisfactory way of measuring poverty. Poverty is multidimensional. There are many other aspects to do with capabilities, choice, security, power, resources. So we push very much for this, and we're happy that the definitions of poverty are broader than just income. Inequality is in there in the new framework. We were happy with that. We also pushed for alternative indicators of economic growth. We are obsessed at the moment as a global society with GDP measured growth. It's a very narrow measure of economic growth. We're now saying let's include social and human capital, environmental capital, and let's measure those as well as indicators of progress or otherwise. Tackling climate change is in the new. We were successful in getting that in there. We were very afraid with the new climate agreement being agreed in December in Paris that the SDG framework wouldn't refer to climate at all, and we would have a sort of a twin-track approach. But climate is in there as one of the SDG goals. Participation is also mentioned frequently in the importance of participation, and we see this as key to delivering on what the SDG framework is promising. But participation means participation by everybody, including citizens, and it's going to be a major challenge, particularly for civil society organizations, to think, how can we mobilize citizens in our own country to become aware of the SDG framework, to get involved in both implementing and also monitoring how it's being implemented. Policy coherence for development. We pushed very strongly for this. The EU is very strong on policy coherence for development, at least in its documents, its policy documents. It's not so good in practice at delivering, but it's paying more and more attention to this issue. We have now got the EU to agree to look at policy coherence for sustainable development, because there's a big difference and we have to keep the focus on sustainability. Financing for development, I think we're all aware at the end of this week, there's a big financing for development conference in Addis. We hope that there, not just the financial means of implementation will be agreed, but other means of implementation. So the kind of systemic issues we've been talking about, tax, trade, I'm trying to think of the other major issues that we have been focusing on in Addis, technology transfer, capacity building, all of these things also need to be agreed in Addis. Accountability. We've spoken about the importance of holding decision makers to account. Now, with this new global partnership, there is a fear that there'll be less emphasis on the primary responsibility of states to deliver on this. So this, the Beyond 2015 campaign has been very clear in saying governments are the primary duty bearers. They have to create the enabling conditions for this ambitious framework to be implemented. Of course, all of the rest of us, private sector, civil society, must get involved in a very serious way in implementing it. But the primary duty bearers to enable it to happen are our governments, and we have to hold them to account. The global partnership versus the state as the duty bearer, that's the kind of the point I've been covering. We are happy to see the idea of a global partnership, which was one of the goals in the MDGs but never realized. It is now a part of this Goal 17 and the Sustainable Development Goal framework. But we don't want it just to be left as a kind of a fuzzy, abstract construct or idea. We want to see it becoming a reality. So I think after 15 years of implementing the SDG framework, we will be able to say, is this truly a global partnership or not? But in looking at it, we have to say, this is not a partnership of equals. So in a way, we do want to encourage a new paradigm that means it's not North-South anymore and these dependent, aid-focused relationships with the South. But at the same time, we have to recognize that there's huge inequalities between the partners in terms of wealth, resources, power, and so on. And we want to see the global partnership reflecting that. Sorry, I know I'm just due to finish up now. So I think you've gone through all of this already, the goals, the 169 targets, the indicators, the final indicators for using to measure progress on these global goals and targets will be agreed in March next year. And I've just mentioned the means of implementation as well. All of these areas are going to be looked at in Addis and hopefully some satisfactory agreement reached on them. What next? I better finish off by telling you what happens next. So I hate to tell you that having told you all about the Beyond 2015 Global Civil Society campaign, it is due to dissolve after the summit in September, after the UN summit at which hopefully the SDG framework and the declaration will be agreed and adopted. The global campaign that wanted to influence this framework is going to disband or it will be no more. But that does not mean that civil society is going to sit back and just let the framework happen. We realize we have to be involved in a very active way. So what we are going to do, firstly, as a European task force, is in October in Brussels, we're organizing a workshop for stakeholders, for all the members of the European task force, and we have over 100 members that can join us in Brussels to talk about. We will provide information and analysis, intelligence from what happened at the UN summit in New York in September, and also plan and strategize on how we're going to hold decision makers, particularly our governments, accountable for delivering on what they have promised to do. So what we are going to do, and I'll skip that one and go to the very last slide, we are going to set up what is called SDG Watch in Brussels. This is going to be a platform of organizations that are interested in seeing the EU properly implement the Sustainable Development Goals. And it is going to consist not just of Concord and its members, we're development and relief focused, most of us, but we are going to come together, as I mentioned in the beginning of my presentation, with other sectors, the environment and sustainability sector. We're going to come together with trade unions, with academics and so on, because we believe that this cross-sectoral approach is going to be essential to monitor the implementation of the goals and also to monitor policy coherence, to see, well, is what's happening in one area, one goal or one set of goals having a negative impact on goals, on other goals in the framework. So this is the first thing we're thinking of doing. It hasn't actually happened yet, but we have had one meeting where we called together interested groups. We have our next meeting on Friday, and the interest that has been shown so far by the other sectors suggests that it will be possible to bring together this wide range of stakeholders to monitor SDG implementation at EU level. And we would like to see if members, you know, there's the same interest at member state level, that this would also happen at a national level, and that a cross-sectoral approach to monitoring any government's implementation of the SDGs happens also across each member state. But that will be obviously a decision for the member states themselves. And this is my final comment, what we call the Beyond 2015 toolbox to help national level organisations to look at how can we monitor properly the implementation of the SDGs in our own countries. This is a very well designed toolbox that was put together with the needs of our organisations, development NGOs and others at national level in mind. And it allows you really to put your thinking caps on and decide, okay, what exactly do we need to do to make sure our governments, excuse me, are properly implementing the SDGs in our country. So I hope you find it useful. You will find it on the Beyond 2015 website. It can be downloaded and we can also, you know, make copies available to you if you're interested. I have just one copy with me here today. So thank you very much for listening to me. I'm sorry if I went slightly over time, and I look forward to any questions later. Thank you.